talk a little bit around, you know, the administrators have things in place, so we're not necessarily talking about them. Let's put them on the shelf for a second. But just as a teacher, whether or not that's happening at the district level, but let's just assume that it is, what is it that I need to do as a teacher to make sure that regardless of what's going on outside, I know my students are experiencing some equitable practices in my classroom?
Okay, so first off, you have to start with the foundation that it has to be done, right? You have to know that work into creating equitable environments has to be done. Because when you don't, like, intentionally engage with that, then the statement that you're making is that it's not important enough for you to engage with it. Whether or not that's your belief, that is a perception that could be had. So one, it has to be done. Recognizing that it has to be done and it should be done. Recognizing that it's not easy, right? Many things that are worth doing are not easy. Recognizing that you don't know everything there is to know about equity and being okay with that. It's something that we teach our students all the time. It's okay not to know. It's not okay to not continually know, to continually not know. That's not okay. Right. So the other thing there is to do your homework and to learn. Not only and by learning, I mean, like, you're doing your own reading, you're doing your own studying. You are engaging with people who know more than you, but you're not only engaging with people who know more than you, because you recognize that, like, you have to do some work on, you have to do the lift. And other people can help you with that. But, like, the primary work is on you. My earbuds keep falling out. Also, you have to know yourself, right? Like know who you are, know from what perspective you're coming from. How do you view the world? How are you interacting with the world? And where are your beliefs coming from? And, like, that's something we all need to really examine. From where are our beliefs coming from? Is it from our own experience? Is it from our family? Is it from, like where is that coming from? And who does that benefit? Does it benefit our students? Does it benefit our society? Where is that coming from? And also recognizing that, yeah, the choice to engage in teaching itself is a political act. So I often hear teachers say, oh, I don't want to get into issues of equity or justice or those sorts of things because I feel like it's political and it's politically divisive. Teaching is political. So, and it doesn't have to be about a party or like one party or another party. It's not about that. It's truly about thought and helping kids engage, in thinking. So all issues are always on the table, and we're just giving students the tools that they need to be able to think through the world around them.
Yeah, absolutely. I love that. So what I heard you say was, as a teacher, before I just jump right in there, I need to look at me, right? So I need to look at my own beliefs and where are my hangups and where are my biases. Mm-hmm. So look at me first. And until I'm able to do that with courage, because it takes courage, and like you said, it's hard work. Until I do that, then I can't do the work, right?
Right.
So cannot do the work. I think that's a perfect answer. And when I think about too, you know, what, when I'm talking to teachers about, you know, because I have some teachers who have done that work that you just outlined, and they've looked at themselves, and then, you know, we start to think about, okay, so what are the questions I need to ask myself to see whether or not I'm putting these things in place in my classroom? So we look at the curriculum, like, is it diverse? But really, I'll take that back. Let me backtrack. The first thing that I tell teachers is to learn who your students are. Do not just rely on what you get on the piece of paper that comes with them on the first day of school. Like, that gives us some information, but we also need to talk to our students and figure out who they actually are, not just on paper and not just visually. That's a, you know, that's an African-American boy, that's a white boy. We need to not just visually know them, but we need to figure out really who they are. And then figure out if our curriculum that we have in place is addressing who they are. And that's the only thing that I would think that as I'm listening to you, the other thing that I tell teachers to do besides the very important work that you just said, is to then get to know those students and to think about what curriculum we're putting in front of them. So
Absolutely. And it, and like you said, basically it's understanding the complexity of intersections, right? So like, I am not only a Black woman, I am also a Black woman who is a mother, who is an educator, who is all of these other things, and recognizing all of that has value and what the value in that is. And how do I bring that to light in, like, in if I was in a classroom, how does an educator, how does my teacher bring all of that to light? Yes. So, Monica, like, we know the actions are empty if the right attitude is not behind it. So what is or isn't the attitude of a teacher who is ensuring educational equity or equity in education, especially in their classrooms?
Absolutely. So, you know, I have heard so often, and I know that teachers mean well when they say this, but they'll say, like, I don't really even see color. I don't really pay attention to gender. I'm just asking the question. Like, they're all my babies and I love them all. And I think that that's great, right? That's rooted in such good intention. But at the same time, we, if we're not acknowledging who our students are, you know, and what cultural backgrounds they have, what differences they bring to the classroom, then we're failing them in a lot of ways. So I think that there is a way to acknowledge it. I think people sort of like toe that line of, you know, I'm not, you know, I don't have gender bias or I don't have racial bias. I just see little blank faces out there, clear children. but, you know, like, we can't. We have to see that that's a girl, that's a boy, this person is Hispanic, this person is Black. We have to know that and recognize that and value that and realize that because they're coming from all these different backgrounds, they bring value to our classrooms. So we cannot just, you know, for lack of a better term, just make that generalization, like, they're just students. There's so much more than that. So I think that, that attitude of I don't see color and I don't see gender and I don't see that is rooted in goodness. I think that we have to make sure that we don't adopt that attitude, but we adopt the vision that we see all these different diversities. Like, that's the very, very, very first thing that I think teachers have to do. And then also just, you know, it just popped in my head about, you know, diversity in terms of, you know, learning disabilities or a student being gifted. Sometimes we know that when we have a student who perhaps may struggle with reading or they struggle with math, as teachers, we're finding ways to build in those scaffolds for those students and to build in those things that make them able to sit in the same classroom with their peers, to not feel ostracized, to not feel different, and to get the content in their own way. So we have to make sure that when we are making those different adjustments for students, that we are not sending the message that to those students that they're too much work. Oh my gosh, you're too much work for me. Oh, wait, I need you to go see Miss So-and-so because I didn't have a chance to make that extra test that you had to make. Like, it takes too long for me to make the font large for you or whatever. Like, I've seen that happen, and that just sinks a student. Like, you can see them sort of go within themselves. So we have to make the different practices that we're doing for students seem seamless. Right. And I know when someone comes from the university, like the students that you're working with, they're coming from the university and then they're going into the classrooms because they have you, they may have that on their mind. But the vast majority of teachers who are leaving the university, they don't have a Jamela who is guiding them to think about these things. And so I think teachers also have to give themselves the time and the space to get better, surround themselves with other educators that are doing this in the right way. But they have to get to the point where this becomes seamless. Like, I can give this person this assignment, this person that assignment, and none, you know, nobody is the wiser. We're all in here learning together. And you shared some years ago with me, Jamela, a strategy that you use in your classroom. And it was around just, you know, when you have students who struggle, who may not always feel confident raising their hands. Like, you talked about how you would say, if you know the answer, raise your right hand. You didn't even know I remember that, right? If you don't know the answer, raise your left hand. And I will know whether or not you want me to call on you. Little things like that, when teachers become more cognizant of the fact that they can make these little subtle shifts in their classroom, just that action with that attitude that I'm not going to make my student feel like he's left out or different. Like, that means everything. So the long way around is just to see our students and meet them where they are, and to make sure that the supports that we're putting in place for them are not ever presented in such a way that it means that it has taken up too much of our time or that it's a burden. They should never feel like a burden to us. So I'll just put that in there. And like I said, there's so much we can say about this huge topic.
Absolutely. But and to touch on one of the things that you said, like the attitude of, like, it's awesome that you remember that. I don't even know, like, you're so weird. But I love that you remember that. But like, even like showing me that sort of, I can learn, like, there's something to learn from you, and I am always learning from you, and you are learning from me, and that there's this exchange that we are interacting with each other. It's such an important attitude for educators who are committed to equity to have.
Yeah. So, so
there are two other things that I do want to mention. One, I want educators to know that we are always already working in this system and these structures that are built in barriers to equity, and we have to intentionally push back against them. So there are already things in place, like there's systems in place outside of our control, but we are a part of those systems. So it's our job to, like, change those systems in any ways that we can. And also to, like, be kind and gentle with yourself through this process of engaging with with equity in all forms, because, like, we are always, always becoming, and, like, we're talking about this equity conversation, but, like, I had struggles with equity earlier today, and like having to check myself. Like, I am always having to do the work. Like, it's not a done. There's no finish line to this thing that we're talking about. It is a constant process that we're engaging with. So I want educators to, like, be gentle with yourself and knowing that it's a process, being accepting of the process, but still being willing to go forward with it.
Yeah. And I'll add to that too. I think that's beautiful and brilliant, and it's so important. As we work with our colleagues too, we have to also have a little willingness to forgive, right? And to correct, and correct with love, and correct with responsibility, and correct with, you know, this is my moral responsibility to make sure that you know this, because I don't want you to say this to a student to make them feel uncomfortable. So you should know, like, that comment you made might be offensive, right? So we have to leverage our ability to converse with each other as educators who are professionals. And when we are in those conversations, we can't take them personally. We have to sort of make sure that we're saying it in the right way, when we're the ones who are correcting something, but also that we're receiving those things in the right way. Right. Mm-hmm. So, but giving ourselves the time and the space, and also, like, finding ways to have those conversations. I think that every school should make sure that there is, at some point, once a month, some type of equity conversation. I just think it's so important that we do that, and we name it, and we provide the time and the place for people to engage in those conversations.
I absolutely agree. But I will also add, I'm only going to be nice about it so many times, because you need to be doing your homework. Stop being
lazy. I'm not going to keep telling you this.
I'm not going to keep doing that with you. You can figure this out. So that's all I wanted to add. But so, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for joining us tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, and however you are identifying yourself, see, like, that's my issue with equity. I'm still working through, I'm still learning the language, but I am committed to that work. So all people of the world, thank you for joining us tonight. And please join us at our equity strand at the conference, and continue to engage with us from now up until then.
Absolutely. And in the chat, in the comments on the Facebook Live, we will drop in a couple of resources to get you started. but in this work and starting to think about this. But if you go to the InStory page, there is a whole link of a whole section of resources in there that can get you started in having these conversations and starting with your curriculum. So please, please, please check those out. And as Jamila said, we're so excited that you joined us and we cannot wait to see you at the conference.
Night.
Good night.